Thanks a lot for the invitation and thanks a lot for the very nice, very kind introduction. So in this talk, I would like to present some more recent and less recent results concerning two variational non-local problems that are very closely related one to each other. So on one side, we would consider the problem of studying stationary points of what is usually called the fractional or the non-local perimeter. And on the other side, on the more PV side, I will consider what is usually called the fractional version of the Allen-Cahn equation. So as Manuel said, I did my PhD in Barcelona with Xavier Cabré, and I started to study this problem at that time. So some of the results are quite old because they were part of my PhD thesis, but the main topic and the main focus of this talk will be some recent results, and in particular our interest is in the class of solutions of stationary points that we are going to consider, because in this talk I will focus on stable solutions, both for the fractional perimeter or for the fractional Allen-Cahn. But before going to these more recent results, I would like to give a description and, let's say, a global picture of the problem, and so the original version of the conjecture by Ennio De Giorgi in the classical case for the Laplacian. So of course, I suppose that here there are people who already know very well this kind of stuff, like Manuel, for example. But okay, I decided to start for these very classical results for people who never saw them before. So let me start. I forgot to say that this result, the recent result that I'm going to present, are collaborations with Xavier Cabré and Joaquin Serra, some of them, and with Joaquin Serra and Enrico Baldinucci, some others. Okay, so let us start with a very classic. Okay, now, sorry, I cannot move anymore my. Before it was working, let me. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, sorry, because I could not change slide. Okay, so let me start with something that is very well known and is very classical. This is a conjecture by Ennio De Giorgi in 1978 about solution of the Allen-Cahn equation. So suppose that we have a bounded solution of this equation that is related to phase transition problems. And suppose that this solution is monotone in one direction, for example, in the last one. So we have this condition on the derivative in xn. Then at least when the dimension n is less or equal than 8, u should depend only on one Euclidean variable, on one direction. When a function satisfies this property, we say that it is one-dimensional, or it satisfies a one-dimensional symmetry. And this is equivalent to say that its level sets are all flat, are hyperplanes. So the motivation for this conjecture relies precisely in the connection, in a very important relation that we have between these, the energy function associated to the Allen-Cahn equation. I always have problem in changing slides. It's slow. I don't know why it's very slow. We have this very well-known result in calculus of variation, that is the Modica-Mortola theorem, which tells us that when we consider the energy function associated to the Allen-Cahn equation, that is given by this sum, where W, the potential, has this double well structure. So it has two minimum point and plus one and minus one, and it's positive elsewhere. After suitably rescaling this functional with a parameter epsilon, Modica and Mortola prove that this rescaled functional gamma converge, so it's a convergence in the, so it's the gamma convergence result to the area, the perimeter functional, where the perimeter is the perimeter in the sense of the Giorgi. So the point is now, of course, that since gamma convergence is a very good notion of convergence for variational problem for minimizers, What do we know about what the George knew at the time already about minimizers for the limiting functional, for the perimeter functional? And here, again, sorry, I always have to wait some time for changing slide. I don't know why, let me.
Maybe you can try to leave the full screen.
Exactly, this is what I was trying to do, but this is also slow.
Okay.
So, I already did ask and I'm waiting to, I don't know why, before the connection when I was trying, it was working perfectly.
You can also try to unshare and share again, maybe.
Yeah, maybe yes.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay, I'm sorry, but I really don't know what is the problem. So if I do this, okay, now I try to share again. Okay, now it's not in full screen mode. I don't know if you can see it. Of course, it's a bit smaller. Can you see it?
Sí.
Okay, is it fine if I leave it like this? And let's see if it's faster. Okay, sorry. So the question was, what do we know about minimizers for the this gamma limit that was the perimeter functional? Here I collect all the known results. I'm sorry if I don't put all the references, but I mean, these are very known facts from the 60s. So let me just mention what are really the one that I relate to what I'm going to consider later. So the first very important result is that if we consider cones that are minimizers for the perimeter functional in the whole space Rn, then they are necessarily flat, they are necessarily hyperplanes up to dimension 7. So we cannot have singular cones in dimension lower than 8. And this dimension 7 is optimal. Indeed, in dimension 8, we have the first example of a singular cone, which is an area minimizing surface that is given by the Simons cone. Related to this, to the classification of cones, we have other two important results that comes just as a consequence of this. The first one is that if we consider any minimizer of the perimeter functional, so not necessarily a cone, which again is a minimizer in the whole space, in the whole Rn, then it is flat up to dimension 7. So this can be obtained by the classification of cones just by using a blow up and blow down argument. And related to these questions, we have what we usually call the Bernstein problem, that is exactly the same kind of results, but for minimal graphs. So if we assume our set to be not only a minimizer for the perimeter, but to be the subgraph of some function, then we have again flatness up to dimension 8. So we have one dimension more in this statement, you see. So somehow the George conjecture in its original statement that was for monotone solution is closely related to the last point, to the Bernstein type result. And for this reason, you see the dimension 8 arising in the conjecture. So now just, I emphasize that here all these results are for minimizers. So when I speak about, I didn't write the definition because it's, it's very standard, but I tell it in words. When I speak about, when I say that a set E is a minimizer for the perimeter functional in the whole Rn, I mean that when I look at the perimeter of E inside a ball of reduced R, the perimeter of E inside a ball of reduced R is less or equal than the perimeter of any admissible competitor F inside the same ball, where the competitor is admissible if it coincides with the outside of the ball. So this is the notion of minimality in a ball VR. And if I ask my set to be a minimizer in the whole Rn, this just means that I require it to be a minimizer in VR for any R. Okay, so I can take the ball as large as I want. Of course, I need to localize the notion of perimeter, otherwise in the whole space, it would be not finite. Okay, so this is just the usual notion of minimality. So now my question, and this is the focus of this talk, is what about stable sets? Where stable has to be understood in the, again, in the variational sense. So basically what I'm requiring is that that the second variation of the energy, that in this case is the perimeter functional, is non-negative. So of course, the first observation is that stability is a weaker notion than minimality, because basically a set is stable if it is if it minimizes the perimeter, but just with respect to small perturbation, very small perturbation. So it's in particular, if E is a minimizer, then it is also a stable set. So this is a more general concept. Okay. And the interesting point here is that even in the classical setting, so I'm speaking about classical perimeter, if we want to classify stable sets in the whole space, then we know that they are flat, but just in two dimension. Actually, the case of dimension four is, this is a very recent paper, and the conjecture is that they should, so we think, people think that they should be flat up to dimension seven, exactly as it happens for minimizers, okay? But this is still a conjecture, and in dimension between five and seven, it is open. Observe as a remark that if we restrict to the class of cones, so stable cones are instead classified, and they are classified exactly as minimal cones. So we know that there are not singular stable cones up to dimension seven. So the problem to give a positive answer to the this conjecture is somehow to pass from the classification of cones to the classification of any stable surface. And the problem, one of the main obstructions in this procedure, is that one would like to have to know some energy estimate. I call them energy, but in this case, of course, our perimeter estimate, because my energy is now the perimeter. So in particular, we would like to know that if we have a stable set, then the perimeter of this set in a Bolova reduced R is bounded above up to a constant by R to the power n minus one. This is precisely the perimeter estimate that we have for minimizer, and it's well known for minimizers. In general, of course, giving energy estimates for minimizers is easier because we use the minimality. So it's enough that usually you argue by comparison. It's enough that you build a competitor which satisfy the suitable estimate that you want. And then my minimality, of course, also your object, your minimizer satisfy the same estimate. But as I already said before, now stability somehow is just a minimality with respect to small perturbation. So your competitor should be a small perturbation of the original set. You cannot choose any, I mean, you cannot change your set inside the ball as you like. So of course, getting energy estimates for stable objects is much harder than for minimizers. And as you will see, energy estimates will be crucial and a very important stuff in all this talk. Okay, so this is just at least to show you that even in the classical local setting, classifying stable objects is hard, and there are still open questions even for the classical local setting. Now let's go back just to give you some references to the classical De Giorgi conjecture. Also here, I apologize, I didn't write all the names of people who works on this, just I want to give you the results. So the Giorgi conjecture is in its original statement that was for monotone solutions, is almost completely solved. There is just one point missing, and is the following. So it's the conjecture has been proven in dimension two and three. So this were paper by Gusov and Gui and Ambrosio Cabré, Alberti Ambrosio Cabré. And then Sabin proved the conjecture up to the optimal dimension eight, but he needed to assume furthermore then the solution tends to the two minimum points of the potential, so plus one, minus one, in the direction of monotonicity. And then we have counterexample by Manuel, Kovács, and Wei in large dimension. So the only missing point concerning the original conjecture basically is to remove this additional assumption on the limits of the solution. And as you will see, this is related to study stable solution. I will comment on this later on. Okay. Then of course one could say, well, but if we look at what I described before, at the motivation Or did the Georgi conjecture relying on these modicum modular type results? Well, these problems are very variational. And the modicum modular result is very good. I mean, is perfect for considering minimizers. So we could ask whether the Georgi conjecture holds true, not instead then asking for monotone solution, considering solutions that are minimizers of the, sorry, of the associated energy functional. So somehow this is, let's say, another version of the Georgi conjecture, but it's very natural. And indeed, it is true. And here, as you see, the critical dimension is 7, as we expect from the classification of area minimizing surfaces that I gave you before. For area minimizing surfaces, the critical dimension for being flat was 7. Okay, 8 was for the Bernstein problem. Okay, so this is exactly the analog for the for solutions of the PD. So again, here I'm considering these two class of solutions, monotone and minimizers. So again, the question is, what about stable solution? Well, again, stable means second variation of the energy functional, now is the Allenkamp energy, being non-negative. And here again, you see that what we know, so we know that stable solution are one dimensional, only in dimension 2. So very low dimension, okay? Then we have counterexample in large dimension, where large means bigger than larger or equal than 8. That is the good one, the critical one. But the conjecture that we expect to be true as we expect to be through the classification of stable minimal surfaces up to dimension 7 is still open. So I want to stress that even in dimension three for the classical Allenkamp with the Laplacian, we don't know whether stable solutions are one dimensional. Okay, and then now what I'm going to do and what the problem which we were interested in is to study these kind of questions, but for the fractional, for a non-local version of both problems. So non-local perimeter and non-local Allenkamp. And as you will see, there are some nice, so there is something nice. So basically that we can deduce something that we don't know how to do it in the local setting, but okay, let's see. So now I move to the fractional side. So of course, what I'm going to consider is just the fractional version of the Allenkamp equation, meaning that I replace the Laplacian with a fractional Laplacian here, the operator. So S for me is a real number between 0 and 1. Fractional Laplacian can be defined in several ways via Fourier transform, or for example, here I just use the definition via the singular integral in the principal value sense, of course. Okay, this is a non-local operator, and you know that there are many people interested in studying this kind of problems of operators. So now the question is, of course, whether can we prove some results that go in the direction that I described before, like, for example, one-dimensional symmetry for monotone solution or minimizers or stable solution. The first natural question is, before I said that one motivation for the Georgi for doing his conjecture was this relation with the perimeter functional. So the first question is whether also in this setting we have a relation with some geometric object. So if we have some kind of modicum ortola type result. The answer is yes, this was proven by Savin and Valdinoci. So if you consider the energy functional associated to the fractional Allenkamp, so basically, of course, what changes here is the Dirichlet term. Now you have this fractional Sobolev term here instead of the Dirichlet integral. Then they prove that again, after a suitable rescaling, you have a gamma convergence result. And what is interesting, of course, is what is the gamma limit? And it turns out that the gamma limit is the classical perimeter. So you get exactly the same that you have for S equal to 1, when S is larger or equal than 1/2. And is a new object that is a fractional perimeter or S perimeter when S is below 1/2. So what is the fractional perimeter? The fractional perimeter, I just give you the definition in the whole space just for simplicity. So if you have a set E, think for example to a bounded set E in Rn, the fractional, the S perimeter of E is just the fractional sobole semi-norm here root W 2S1 of its characteristic function. So recall that the perimeter in the sense of the Georgi is the BV semi-norm bounded variation, in the sense of bounded variation, norm of the characteristic function. So it's somehow this is it's reasonable to call this a perimeter is of fractional order, let's say, yes, perimeter, okay. Here I just emphasize the notation just for people who maybe are used to a different notation. So to be consistent with the notation that I used for the fractional Laplacian, here in my kernel, you see I have power n plus 2s. Here I have 2s. And for this reason, of course, I have to restrict. So the S perimeter is well defined for S strictly below 1/2, because it's precisely the range for which characteristic function belongs to the space. Okay. So yeah, I use the notation just to be consistent with the notation for the with the fractional Laplacian. If we go back, sorry, just for 1 second to this gamma convergence result, and we ask, what do we expect about a fractional version of the De Giorgi conjecture? Of course, you can immediately think, well, when S is larger or equal than 1/2, in the limit, you see the same object that is a local object, is the classical perimeter. So we expect the De Giorgi conjecture to be true exactly as so in the same dimensions as in the classical case, so up to dimension 8. But when S is below 1/2, then the gamma limit is this new object. So the first question is, are we able to classify S minimal surfaces, so sets that are minimizers for the S perimeter? So I go now to this question. And here, as you will see, there are still many, many open questions. Indeed, the only available result that holds for any S in the range 0/1/2 is a result in dimension 2. So Savin and Baldinucci proved that any minimal cone in the for minimal, I mean now for the S perimeter, okay, for the S perimeter is flat, so it is an half plane in dimension 2. And as a consequence of this, again, we can deduce that any minimal set, not necessarily a cone, but any minimal set, again, is flat in the same dimension. And if we ask our set to be a subgraph, so the analog of the Bernstein problem, then we can go to one dimension more, 12-3, exactly for the same reason that, so in the same way that happened in the classical setting. And then another result concerning fractional minimal surfaces is, the results are true for any S between 0 and 1/2, but when S is very close to 1/2, Caffarelli and Baldinucci prove that you can recover all the classical theories, so all the classification that I showed you before for the minimizer of the classical perimeter by a compactness argument. Indeed, you can prove that the S perimeter multiplied by the right factor, that was like 1/2 minus S, tends to the classical perimeter when S tends to 1/2. And then by compactness, you can prove the same classification of a minimal S minimal set if S is sufficiently close to 1/2. Of course, there are many open questions, right? I mean, just dimension 3 classifying minimal cones for any S in dimension 3 is still open. Okay, once we have this result at hand, of course we can go back to the De Giorgi, and here again I give you just a list of the known results before passing to our contributions. And as I told you, when S is larger or equal than 1/2, we expect exactly the same results to be true as in the classical setting. And this is exactly, and indeed, these results have been proven. Okay, here I put all the references. So in dimension 2 and 3, we can prove the Giorgi conjecture both for monotone solution and for minimizers. So in both versions, let's say. And then we have the Giorgi conjecture for minimizers up to dimension 7, and for monotone solution up to dimension 8, but again requiring this limiting assumption. Okay, so this is exactly the same. The result by Savin is exactly the corresponding result of what I showed you before. Let me mention, before I forgot to mention this, sorry, let me mention that the reason for requiring this limiting assumption is precisely because Savin worked with minimizers. So he needed, all his theory is done for minimizers. And if you you can prove that if you have a monotone solution which tends to plus one and minus one in the direction of monotonicity, then in particular it is a minimizer, and so its theory can be applied. Because so this is really a theory for minimizers. And here, so these are the results that more or less were expected. Of course, the proof are more involved because you have to deal with this non-local operator, but okay, but it works. I mean, you can do it. Something that indeed, that instead it's more, I think, okay, not more, everything is interesting, but it's very interesting because it does not have a correspondence in the local case, is a result by Alessio Figali and Joaquin Serra. That here I put it in red to emphasize the result, because they were able to prove for the specific case of the half Laplacian, so when S is equal to 1/2, they were able to prove that the Georgi conjecture in dimension 4 for monotone solutions without requiring the limited assumptions. Okay, so this is something that is still open for the case of the Laplacian when S is equal to 1, because for the case of the Laplacian, the only result in dimension 4 is the result by Savin where he needs the limiting assumption. Okay, so this is something in which you already see that the non-locality sometimes can help. And again, I will come back to this result later, because this is related to the study of stable solution. But let me go on just with the references. So when S instead is below 1/2, we have said that the gamma limit is the S perimeter, and we have said that we have very few information, only in very low dimension, on minimizers for the S perimeter. And this is also reflected, as you can imagine, on the PD side, on the Allen-Kahn side. Indeed, for S below 1/2, we know, so the Georgi conjecture has been proven for minimizers in dimension 2, and for monotone solutions up to dimension 3. If you remember, this corresponds precisely to the Bernstein type result up to dimension 3, and this just to the classification of minimizers. Okay, and then when S is close to 1/2, again, this is related to the classification of S minimal surfaces by Caffarelli and Baldinucci by compactness. When S is equal to 1/2, you can recover the Georgi conjecture in the original statement, okay, so up to dimension 7 and 8. So again, for example, here the case of minimizers for S below 1/2 in dimension 3 is open. Okay, this perfectly reflects the problems and the difficulties that we have in the geometric problem in the classification of S minimal surfaces. So now, I want to speak about stable solutions. Before going to the study of stable solutions, let me just tell you some words on the proof. Of course, I don't have time to do all the detailed proof, but at least to try to make you understand why the proof in low dimensions, so in particular also, for example, when we study stable solution in low dimensions, it's easier. While in higher dimension is harder. Well, of course, one can imagine that when you go to higher dimension, things becomes harder, but I want to give you really a more precise idea of this fact. So this is what I'm going to describe now is something that is the same both for the fractional problem or for the classical problem, okay? So basically the idea is that if you are in low dimension, and low means 2 or 2 and 3, depending on if you are fractional or non-fractional, but okay, let's say dimension 2, for example, you can prove that the Georgi conjecture just using a purely PD techniques. So you don't have to use the classification of minimal cones, so area minimizing surfaces. So that classification, so that the geometric problem was somehow a motivation for the De Giorgi conjecture, but to prove the De Giorgi conjecture in low dimension, you don't need to know it. So you can prove it directly without knowing anything about minimal cones and so on. And why? Because you have this proof. For example, now I'm thinking to the proof by Ambrosio Cabré, but all the proof in low dimension are of this kind. So in the proof of the De Giorgi conjecture in low dimension, basically you have to use three main ingredients. The first one is stability of solutions. So here again, stability comes in. And I just make you notice that, of course, minimizers are a stable solution. And you can prove that also monotone solutions are stable solutions. So both minimizers and monotone solution belongs to this class, okay? And then a crucial point is an energy estimate. So if you are able to prove that the energy, indeed the Dirichlet part of the energy is enough, that the Dirichlet part of the energy of your solution is bounded above by R square log R, sorry, the energy in a ball of radius R is bounded above by R square log R, then using a Liouville type result, you can deduce one-dimensional symmetry, okay? So this scheme could be, so the scheme works, not works, but I mean, you can do this scheme in particular, you can write the Liouville type result in any dimension N. The problem is that, that you need this growth for the energy. And typically the energy, for example, if you think to the classical Alencon equation or to the classical perimeter, the energy in a ball of radius R grows as R to the power n minus one when n is the dimension. So you see that to get R square, you can get it just if you are in dimension two or three, okay? And all these facts cannot be improved. I mean that the energy estimate is optimal. You cannot get something better than R to the power n minus one, even for minimizers. This is the optimal estimate for minimizers. And also this is optimal, this result is optimal in the power. So if you have here a power larger than two, then you cannot, so you don't have a Liouville type result with here a power larger than two, okay? So if you go through this, if you use this proof, you are you see immediately that it can work just in low dimensions, okay? So as just to make you see in the fractional setting, we proved this was an older result. This was part, for example, of my PhD thesis, that when you consider the fractional Alencon equation and you consider minimizers, these are the optimal energy estimates. Okay, so when S is above 1/2, you have exactly the same estimate as in the classical setting, N minus one, and they are getting worse when S goes below 1/2. You have this critical, the critical exponent S equal to 1/2, which gives you this logarithmic term. And then when S is below 1/2, you have this growth power N minus 2S. So from this, and these are optimal, eh? Okay? So from this, you can see that if you want to use this PD proof that does not rely on the classification of minimal cones, then you can prove the Giorgi only in this case, when S is larger or equal than 1/2, you can arrive to dimension three. And if S is below 1/2, you are stuck with dimension two, okay? Because in dimension three, N minus 2S is already too big to use the scheme that I showed you before. Okay. But then the question, of course, is, well, but we have the proof by Savin for large dimensions. So let us see what this proof uses. And so if we want to prove that the De Giorgi conjecture in the high dimensional case, meaning dimension larger than three, for example, then you really, so this is the proof by Savin, you really need to use the geometric problem. So basically what you need are three ingredients. Each of these is a very, you have to prove it and it's not obvious at all, okay? So the first ingredient is that you need to prove that when you rescale, you do blowdowns of your solutions. So for example, Savin was considering minimizers. When you do blowdowns of minimizers, of your energy functional, then they converge in a quite strong sense, because you want out of convergence for the level sets, to area minimizing surfaces. Okay. And then you need to know what these minimizing surfaces could be. So, for example, in the classical setting, we already know that up to dimension 7, any minimizing surface is flat. Okay, so if we already know the classification of area minimizing surface, then we know that in dimension, for example, up to dimension 7, the blowdowns converge to something flat, to hyperplanes. Okay. And then the improvement of flatness tells you then your origin, the level sets of the original solution before doing the blowdown were flat. So this means that the solution must be one dimensional. So in the high dimensional case, you really need to use the classification of area minimizing surfaces. And of course, when you go to the fractional setting in the non-local regime, so meaning S below 1/2, this is still an open problem. So in dimension 3, we even don't know the classification of minimal cones. Okay. Okay, so this is just to more or less to give you a global picture of the problem and what are the main difficulties. And now I want to make a remark that I announced before, why it's interesting and we were interested in studying stable solutions. Okay. First, because it's interesting in itself. I told you that stability is a more general, is a weaker notion than minimality, both for the geometric problem, of course, than for the PDE. For the PDEs, is also more general than monotone solutions, okay? And as I told you, even in the classical setting, so for the case, for example, of the classical Alencan, the classical Laplacian, the De Giorgi conjecture for stable solution in dimension 3 is open. Okay, so this is interesting in itself, but it's interesting also because this implication holds true. So this implication tells us that if we were able to prove the De Giorgi conjecture for stable solution in one dimension less, so in Rn minus one, knowing, and if we already know, and for the classical case, we already know this is the result by Savin, we know that the Giorgi conjecture for minimizers in Rn, these two facts together would imply that the Giorgi conjecture for monotone solutions in Rn. So if we are able to prove that, for example, if we are able to prove that stable solutions of the classical Alencan equation are one dimensional in dimension 3, this automatically would give you that monotone solutions are one dimensional in dimension 4 without requiring the limiting assumption by Savin. Okay, so proving the conjecture for stable solution would imply in one dimension more the conjecture for monotone without limiting assumption. Okay, so this is also, of course, another reason for studying this problem. And now let us go to the main point that I wanted to tell you today, that is we are interested in studying stable objects. I wrote objects in general because I will focus both on the fractional perimeter and on the fractional Alencan, in the fractional setting. So I start with the geometric problem. So the question now is, what can we say about stable critical points of the S perimeter? So about surfaces that are stationary for the S perimeter and for which the second variation of the S perimeter is non-negative. So these are some recent results, okay, recent, but this is already 3 years now, that I obtained with Joaquin Serra and Enrico Valdinoci. So the first result is that we could prove energy estimates that, as I try to explain you, are quite important in this kind of problems. Energy estimates with the optimal bound that is exactly the same that holds true for minimizers. So we were able to prove that if we have a stable set for the S perimeter, then its S perimeter in a ball of radius R is bounded above by R to the power n minus 2s. And this is in any dimension. Recall that for the classical perimeter, These estimates are only known in low dimensions. So there is not an analog of this for stable objects for the classical perimeter. So again, here the no locality of the problem helps in getting something that we are not able to get for in the classical setting, okay? And then another estimates, what we call BV estimates, is that not only we are, we gave a bound on the S perimeter, that is the energy of our problem, but we were able also to give a bound on the classical perimeter. So this is, can be seen somehow as a sort of, I would call it a regularity results, because our object are stable objects for S perimeter, so something of order 2S with S below 1/2, so of order less than 1. And here we are getting estimates for the BV semi-norm of the characteristic function, so order 1. Okay, so this is not just, so I mean, this is just an energy estimate, this is some kind of regularity estimate. So we proved this with Enrico and Joachim, and basically, of course, here the constants blows up when S tends to 1/2. Okay, otherwise we could get we could get the statement for classical for the classical perimeter. Let me tell you that the idea of the proof, okay, the proof is a bit involved, but the idea is that we consider so if we have our set P that is a stable set for the S perimeter, we consider perturbations of E given by very small translation in some fixed direction. And then we have to compute the difference in energy between the competitor and our set. Okay, and we have to do many computations, but the point is that we consider small perturbations. And for this reason, we can work with stable objects, because as I told you, stability is minimality with respect to small perturbations. Okay, as a consequence, in particular, okay, this is an easy consequence, but it's something new. We could extend the result, the classification of stable sets, the classification of minimal sets in dimension 2 by Savin and Baldinucci, we could extend it to the class of stable sets. Because once you know the perimeter estimate, the S perimeter estimate, you can directly prove flatness. So you can prove that the only stable set is an out plane. Again, here, sorry, my time, okay, I don't have much time, so maybe I just give you the main point without entering the proofs. And then in another paper with Cabré and Joaquin, we consider the case of dimension 3. So in this second result, we consider stable cones, which are smooth away from the origin, in dimension 3, in R3, and we were able to prove that if S is sufficiently close to 1/2, then again, they are necessarily flat. Here, the point, of course, the point are two. The first one is that, again, we consider stable cones, not minimizers, okay? And the other one is that this is not a result obtained by compactness from the case of the classical perimeter. So this S star can be quantified, okay? So this is not a result like the one by Caffarelli and Baldinucci. But the main point in which we were interested here is that the class of cones that we consider is the one of stable cones. This was just step of the proof, but maybe I go on because I don't have much time. And I want to finish going back to the Alencan. So I give you some results for stable objects, for stable sets for the fractional perimeter. And of course, now the question is whether we can do something similar, we can obtain similar results for stable solutions of the fractional Alencan. So we consider, we have to restrict to the range S below 1/2, because it's the non-local regime is the one in which we could apply the technique developed with Enrico and Joachim for S minimal surfaces. And with Cabré and Joachim Serra, we first proved the corresponding estimates. So the first estimate somehow is the corresponding of what I called before the BV estimate for stable solutions. And the second one is the energy estimate. So again, here we can put this estimate for stable solutions in any dimension. And again, there is not an analog for stable solution of the classical Alencan, because again, we can just, so we don't have an energy estimate for stable objects in every dimension for the classical Alencan. Okay, this was a sketch of the proof. I just tell you something of the proof. The proof basically of the BV estimate and of the Dirichlet, and on the Dirichlet energy, on the Dirichlet part of the energy, is basically the same that we did for S minimal for S stable surfaces. Is the same. We have just to work with functions U instead than with characteristic functions. But then the additional difficulty here with the Alencan is that we also have a potential term in the energy, not just the Dirichlet part. So we have to prove that the potential term is bounded above by the Dirichlet term. So once you have a bound for the Dirichlet energy, then automatically you have a bound for the total energy. Okay, so yeah, there is a reference of people who also get some BV and Dirichlet estimates, 1D. And now let's go to the final result. Once we have these energy estimates in any dimensions for stable solutions, combining with many other ingredients, so in particular with a monotonicity formula and density estimates, but energy estimates were really, I think, one of the crucial points. We proved the convergence of blowdowns. So what I told you before, in the scheme of the proof by Savin, the first step was take blowdowns of solutions, in this case of stable solutions, and prove that they converge even in the Hausdorff sense to in this case, stable set for the limiting functional that is, in this case, is the fractional perimeter. So we proved this convergence of blowdowns. So once you have this convergence of blowdowns, so here the novelty again is that we did this convergence of blowdowns for stable objects, not for minimizers. Okay, this is the point. Once you have this convergence of blowdowns, basically we have an abstract result that reduces the problem of proving the de Giorgi conjecture for stable solutions to the problem of classifying stable cones for the fractional perimeter. Because of the scheme that I showed you before, you have the convergence of blowdown to an object that now is a stable set for the fractional perimeter. If you are able to prove that that set is necessarily flat, then using an improvement of flatness that was already available, it was proven by Serena Di Pierro, Joaquin Serra, and Enrico Aldinocci, you can prove that your original solution was one-dimensional. Okay, so somehow our main result is this convergence of blowdown, and as a consequence, you get this abstract classification result. So the point is, okay, if you are able to prove that the only stable minimal cones in dimension 3 are flat, automatically by this result, you have proven that the Giorgi conjecture for stable solution in dimension 3, okay? So of course, now I conclude with this. The point is, okay, what are the consequences in concrete cases? So do you discover something new with respect to what was known before? And the answer is yes, because combining this abstract result with the classification of stable cones obtained with Cabré and Joachim in dimension 3 with S close to 1/2, combining these two, we can say then, we deduce that the Giorgi conjecture, so we can deduce one-dimensional symmetry for stable solutions in dimension 3 when S is close to 1/2. And remember that for the classical Laplacian, classifying stable solution dimension 3 was open. Okay, so we get something that that is not known for the classical Laplacian. And as a consequence, since we have classified stable solution dimension 3, for the same S, we have classified monotone solution in dimension four, because you can go to one dimension more without requiring the limited consumption. So this, just to make you a comparison, is exactly the same result that I mentioned before by Figali and Serra. They proved this result for S equal to 1/2. We proved the same result for S below 1/2, sufficiently close to 1/2. Okay. So also Figali and Serra proved first the result for stable solution dimension 3, and then got the De Giorgi conjecture in dimension 4 for monotone solution as a consequence of this. So is the same scheme. Okay, then I just have a final, okay, like, but maybe my time is over, so I stop here. I just wanted to put together all what I said, both for the perimeter and for the Alencan, comparing the non-local setting and the local setting. And you can see, for example, in these slides that somehow the difficulties are interchanged. So for example, having perimeter estimates, we have perimeter estimates in any dimension for the fractional perimeter, but only in low dimension for the classical perimeter. On the other side, the problem of classifying cones, stable cones, we are able to classify stable cones for the fractional perimeter in low dimension, while stable cones for the classical perimeter are classified in any dimension, meaning up to the optimal dimension, that is 7. So I mean that they are flat up to dimension 7. So you have somehow the non-locality here helps in getting the estimates, but then it's harder to classify in cones. And then, okay, here there is a similar scheme for the Alencan, but I think that my time is over. So I just leave the slide here and I stop here. I thank you for your attention.